Amongst all the novel drug delivery systems, osmotic drug delivery system is very popular because of several advantages that it possesses. In this lecture, a review of the older osmotic drug delivery systems, the latest technologies of osmosis will be discussed. The osmotic system mainly consists of three components: a delivery device, that is, and a core and a semi-permeable membrane. An osmotic DDS is a type of novel drug delivery system, and it possesses all the advantages of a novel drug delivery system. So let us look back at what are these advantages. The route of administration of these delivery systems is very convenient and easy. Most of the osmotic delivery systems are given orally. Because they act in a manner that the release of drug is controlled, there is a reduction in the frequency of dosing as well as a significant reduction in the dose that needs to be administered. Such systems are designed to release the drug from the interior, that is the core, at a controlled rate, and thus there is a prolonging of the duration of action. Because the drug delivery is targeted at specific sites and at a constant rate with minimal variation in plasma levels, there is a concomitant reduction in the side effects seen. Drugs can be targeted to the site of action, leading to reduction in the side effects as well as maximal efficiency of the drug. Let us now look at the definition of osmosis or osmotic pressure. Osmotic pressure is the pressure greater than that above the pure solvent and must be applied to the solution to prevent passage of the solvent through the perfect semi-permeable membrane. Osmotic pressure can be determined by use of the osmometer. It is seen that osmotic pressure can be calculated by the Van 't Hoff and Morse equation, which is as follows: pi V is equal to nRT, where pi is the osmotic pressure, V is the volume of the solution in liters, N is the number of moles of the solute, R, that is capital R, is the gas constant, and capital T is the absolute temperature. Thus, osmotic pressure is the pressure greater than that of the solvent, a pure solvent, which must be applied to the solution to prevent passage of solvent from the side of lower concentration to the side of higher concentration through the semipermeable membrane, and it is expressed by the Van 't Hoff and Morse equation, where pi is the osmotic pressure. What are the advantages of such delivery systems? Let us see. Such systems deliver the drug at zero or almost zero order release, and therefore they have been found to be very useful for treatment of chronic conditions. These drugs are delivered in the form of a solution, so they are released from the osmotic system in the form of either a solution or a finely dispersed suspension, leading to quick absorption and increase in the plasma concentration of the drug. The entire drug is protected inside the osmotic device, so it is fully protected from the external environment until the drug is released. Next, the delivery rate is not affected by external conditions of the GI tract, such as gastric motility or pH or presence of interfering food particles, etc. These systems deliver the drug to the system at relatively elevated rates. Those rates are much higher than the rates of diffusion-based delivery systems. There is a very good correlation between in vitro and in vivo data, hence formulation development is easy if such studies are carried out. having different solubility profiles. So right from slightly soluble to highly soluble drugs can be incorporated in these delivery systems and can be formulated into osmotic drug delivery systems that are able to deliver the drug at a constant rate irrespective of the solubility characteristics of the drug that is enclosed. Let us now look at some of the factors that should be considered while designing the formulation. The first and foremost is the solubility of the drug. Solubility is an important aspect because when the drug is soluble, such a drug will dissolve and exert osmotic pressure. Hence, osmotic systems are suitable for highly water-soluble drugs. If the solubility of the drug is low or the drug is dispersed in the fluid, then certain modifiers or osmotic agents need to be added to the formulation. And examples of such osmotic modifiers include polymers, certain carbohydrates, sodium chloride, etc. Next is the osmotic pressure that is exerted by the core components. Here the core components are nothing but the drug and the other osmotic agents, osmotic modifiers that may be added. The maintenance of the saturated solution of osmotic agents inside the compartment is very important. Therefore, selection of the right osmotic agent and its concentration inside the device is very important to maintain the internal osmotic pressure, which is ultimately responsible for drug delivery. Next is the size of the orifice which is drilled into the semipermeable membrane. A typical orifice size is around 600 microns to 1 millimeter through which the drug solution or the drug dispersion comes out. Such an orifice is created by using the laser technique. Lastly, nature of the rate controlling membrane is very important. And an important property that it should possess is that the membrane should be independent of pH as well as agitational movement of the GI tract. Examples of semipermeable membranes that have been employed and are used as coating onto the osmotic delivery systems includes polyvinyl alcohol, methyl cellulose, ethyl cellulose, polyurethane, cellulose acetate butyrate, and so many others. So herein is a list of the preferred semipermeable membranes for controlling the drug delivery by osmosis, and herein is a list of osmotic agents which will build up the osmotic pressure inside the delivery system. So moving forth, now let us try to understand the osmotic drug delivery system. The basic components of the osmotic drug delivery system are the drug, the osmotic agent which is responsible for generating osmotic pressure. Both of these are enclosed in a system that is coated with a semi-permeable membrane as such, or a semi-permeable membrane which is on top of the coating material. Certain polymers that are necessary to build up the size and shape of the delivery system, wicking agents, and pore forming agents. Let us now look at each of these components in detail as we go ahead. When the drug is highly soluble in the formulation, the drug exerts some osmotic pressure. However, this osmotic pressure may not be adequate to ensure delivery of the drug from the inside of the system to the external environment, that is the GI fluid. In such cases, osmotic agents need to be added to the system. And these osmotic components are generally ionic compounds, inorganic salts, or hydrophilic polymers. They can be categorized as water-soluble salts of inorganic acids or water-soluble salts of organic acids or others. The osmotic pressures for concentrated solutions commonly used in such formulations are extremely high. So the osmotic pressure required ranges from 30 atmospheres up to 500 atmospheres. But it's only when such high pressure is built up in the osmotic delivery device that it is able to push the drug out. And this we will see as we go ahead. Such osmotic pressures produce high water flow across the semipermeable membrane and at a constant rate. An important component of the osmotic drug delivery device, which is responsible for delivery of the drug from the device to the GI fluid at a constant rate, is the semipermeable membrane. The semipermeable membrane should possess certain performance criteria such as sufficient wet strength and water permeability, biocompatibility, good rigidity and non-swelling characteristics, and the ability to withstand the pressure that builds up within the device. And this osmotic pressure is as high as 50 atmospheres to anywhere around 300 atmospheres. Any polymer which is permeable to water but impermeable to the solute, that is the drug, can be used as a coating material in these osmotic devices. So common examples of these polymers which can be used are cellulose esters such as cellulose acetate butyrate, cellulose triacetate, ethyl cellulose, as well as eutrogens. The solvents that are used for forming the coating solution are inert, inorganic and organic solvents such as methylene chloride, acetone, methanol, ethanol, isopropyl alcohol, ethyl acetate, cyclohexane, and a combination of two or more of these solvents have also been found to be suitable to give a good coat. So basically, coating polymer, plasticizer, coating solvent is very necessary, selection is very necessary to give a good coat with the ideal semi-permeability characteristics. The polymer of choice can be either hydrophilic or hydrophobic, and these polymers are very important in the development of osmotic systems wherein you have a core that is surrounded by a coat. The selection of the polymer, the nature of the polymer, the molecular weight of the polymer, the degree of cross-linking is based on the solubility of the drug, whether the drug is slightly soluble, soluble, highly soluble, as well as the amount of drug and the rate of drug that is meant to be released from the delivery system once it is administered to the patient. Next, we look at what are called as wicking agents. These wicking agents have performed the function of drawing water inside the core of the tablet. Remember, our delivery system is a dry system like a tablet. In order to generate osmotic pressure, adequate water should enter this delivery system. In order for the water to enter this system, some amount of pulling of the water inside, or what is called as wicking, by creating channels or networks of increased surface area is very necessary. And such a function is performed by the wicking agents. Wicking agent is a material that is designed to draw water into the porous network, that is into the core of the tablet, and create channels or network of increased surface area. The examples of wicking agents include silicon dioxide, kaolin, titanium dioxide, alumina, niacinamide, sodium lauryl sulfate, low molecular weight PVP or bentonite or magnesium aluminium silicate or polyester, polyethylene, etc. So depending upon the rate of entry of liquid, desired rate of entry of liquid into the system, selection of the right wicking agent is very important. Next, we come to what are called as pore forming agents. These agents are particularly used in the pumps that are developed for poorly water soluble agent and in the development of controlled porosity pumps. The pore formers can be inorganic or organic or and solid or liquid in nature. Alkaline metal salts such as sodium chloride, sodium bromide, potassium chloride can be used. Similarly, alkaline earth metals such as calcium chloride and calcium nitrate may be used as pore forming agents. Also, water soluble carbohydrates such as glucose, fructose, mannose, etc. can be used. That was an overview of the formulation aspects of osmotic delivery systems, as well as a brief review of the excipients or additives that are necessary to be added into such delivery systems. Now, let us look at the different types of delivery systems that are actually available. Osmotic pumps may be divided into two classes, that is oral osmotic pumps and implantable osmotic systems. Okay, the oral osmotic pumps are similar to coated tablets or encapsulated granules which can be administered orally. They travel along the GI tract and release the drug at a constant rate, that gives a zero order release, or they may deliver the drug in a pulsated form as timed release dosage forms. Implantable osmotic systems also work on the same principle, but the rate of drug release is very slow and these can release the drug for a period extending into months. And they are generally preferred for potent drugs that require chronic administration, example hormones. So the oral osmotic tablet is further divided into single osmotic pump and multi-chamber osmotic pumps. Under the single osmotic pump, we have the elementary osmotic pump, controlled porosity osmotic pump, and osmotic bursting pump. In case of multi-chamber oral osmotic pumps, the push-pull type of osmotic pump is very popular, as well as the sandwich osmotic type of tablet is popular. Finally, we have capsules similar to oral tablets, and the form of capsules under the category of osmotic capsules, there are five different systems which have been reported: the Oros CT system, L-Oros system, pelleted delayed release capsules, asymmetric membrane capsules, and telescopic capsules for delayed release. Implantable osmotic systems that are available commercially include the Duros osmotic pump and the Alzette osmotic pump. We are going to study a few systems of the oral osmotic type and a few of the implantable osmotic system in our further slides. Thus, osmotic drug delivery devices are of two types: the oral osmotic pumps, which are similar to coated tablets and release the drug slowly and help in achieving an idealistic zero order drug release. Secondly are the implantable osmotic pumps, where the rate of drug release is very slow and can extend over a period of months. These systems are preferred for drug delivery of potent drugs such as hormones. Let us now move forward and look at some of the osmotic drug delivery systems that are commercially available in the market. The first system that we are going to look at is the basic pump that is called as the elementary osmotic pump. Commercially, it is available as Oros. The elementary osmotic pump is the simplest type of osmotic pump and it is popularly called as Oros. It consists of an osmotic core containing the drug, and the composition of the core will depend on the nature of the drug. This core consists of drug and, if necessary, an osmogen or osmotic pressure generating agent. So, if the proportion of drug is insufficient to produce the required osmotic pressure to push the drug out, then an osmogen should be included in the formulation. The core is then coated, you can see the in the red marking, the coating, with a material that forms the semi-permeable membrane. Examples of the polymers that can be used for semi-permeable membrane have already been discussed, right? Now what is needed is an orifice or an opening which through which the drug dispersion moves outwards. An orifice is generally 0.4 mm to 0.6 mm in diameter and is drilled by using laser beam or any other mechanical device. Once administered, the water gets absorbed through the semi-permeable membrane. So if this is the gastric fluid, then water from the fluid enters through the semi-permeable membrane. Water can only enter, it cannot come out because the membrane is semi-permeable. The water then gets absorbed through the semi-permeable membrane. The drug and the osmotic agent dissolve, producing osmotic pressure, which then forces the concentrated drug solution out. Now, because the membrane is semi-permeable, the drug solution cannot move outwards through the semi-permeable membrane. It is therefore pushed towards the orifice, and the drug solution comes out through the orifice. The rate of intake of water through this semi-permeable membrane depends upon the osmotic pressure that is already existing inside the device. At any time, the volume of saturated solution of the drug here is equal to the volume of water intake. And zero order rate of drug release through the orifice continues until all the solid inside the tablet has been dissolved and exhausted. The residual drug solution inside then continues to deliver the drug at a declining rate until the osmotic pressure outside and osmotic pressure inside become equal. Such systems as the elementary osmotic pump are suitable for delivery of drugs which have moderate solubility. Insoluble drugs should not be administered by using such systems. And it has been seen and studied and confirmed that about 60 to 80% of the total drug content in such a delivery system is delivered at a constant or zero order rate, after which the rate of delivery of the drug keeps falling till no more drug is delivered through the device. Next, we have a look at the Rose-Nelson pump. This is the first osmotic pump that was invented by two scientists, Rose and Nelson, in 1955. So you can see that osmotic delivery devices have been around for more than 60 to 70 years. This pump consists of three chambers: a drug chamber or a drug reservoir with an orifice, a salt chamber, and a water chamber. So you can see from right to left, the drug reservoir, salt chamber, and the water chamber. The first two chambers are separated by an elastic diaphragm or a latex diaphragm, and the next two chambers are separated by a semi-permeable membrane. There exists a difference in osmotic pressure across the water chamber and the salt chamber. Because of this, water flows from the water chamber into the salt chamber. This causes an increase in volume of the salt chamber, and the rise in volume in the salt chamber pushes the diaphragm towards the drug solution, and this in turn pushes the drug out from the reservoir through the orifice at a constant rate. This pump was used for delivery of drugs in the gut of veterinary animals. However, this system has a major disadvantage that since water is already present in the system, it will start crossing the semi-permeable membrane and creating, increasing the volume in the salt chamber. Therefore, such systems are so designed that they have to be used immediately. They cannot be stored for later use. Next, we look at what is called as the Higuchi-Leacher pump. This is a simplified version of the Rose-Nelson pump and helps in overcoming the disadvantage of the Rose-Nelson pump. It is devoid of a water chamber, so there is no water inside. It is a bullet-shaped rigid housing having an orifice at the top for delivery of the drug and a perforated bottom. Semipermeable membrane is fixed at the inner surface of the porous membrane support at the bottom. This housing, this pump, is separated into two chambers which are separated by a movable separator. Saturated solution of magnesium sulfate is present in the lower chamber, and this solution contains excess magnesium sulfate. So you have a saturated solution of magnesium sulfate containing excess solid magnesium sulfate in the chamber between the movable separator and the semipermeable membrane. Drug and other additives are packed in the above chamber. Such a device, when administered, is activated by water that that enters from the bottom support through the semipermeable membrane into the saturated magnesium sulfate solution. This increases the volume of the lower chamber and pushes the separator upwards towards the orifice. So drug formulation that is present in the upper chamber is gradually pushed out through the orifice at a constant rate. The advantage of this device is that it can be stored for weeks to months and can be administered only when necessary. Next, we look at the controlled porosity osmotic pump. This is also similar to the other osmotic devices, and it consists of an osmotic core, which is nothing but drug plus osmogen. It varies from the elementary osmotic pump in that it has many micro orifices instead of a single orifice, and the coating, the osmotic core, is coated with a material that is semipermeable membrane and a water soluble material such as polyethylene glycol. So the coating is made up of semipermeable membrane plus polyethylene glycol. When administered, the water soluble material, that is polyethylene glycol, dissolves and forms micropores or channels through which the drug is released at a constant rate, and this continues till the osmotic pressure inside the device is equal to osmotic pressure outside the device. Such a system has an advantage that it can be used for constant delivery, rate delivery of water soluble drugs. In case of water insoluble drugs, agents which are solubilizers for the drug as well as exert osmotic pressure, for example cyclodextrins, can be used to formulate the controlled porosity osmotic pump. So controlled porosity osmotic pump uses the principle of osmosis for delivery of drugs at a constant rate. It differs from the previously explained examples of osmotic pumps in that it consists of multiple orifices through which the drug solution is exerted out, and these multiple orifices are created by using water soluble materials in the semipermeable membrane. So the semipermeable membrane takes up water, delivers it to the inside, pressure is exerted, and the drug solution comes out through the pores that are manifested by dissolution of the water soluble material such as PEG. Next, we look at the push and pull type of osmotic pumps. These are also called as push-pull osmotic systems and have been marketed to extend the release of poorly soluble compounds for various indications such as hypertension, diabetes, and asthma, that is chronic diseases. Push-pull pump is used to deliver both poorly soluble as well as highly water-soluble drugs at a constant rate, and it is designed as a bilayered tablet in which the upper layer consists of drug and the lower layer consists of an osmotic agent. Such a bilayered tablet is then coated with a semipermeable membrane and an orifice is drilled on the drug layer side. When such a system is placed in the GI environment, water is attracted inside the tablet in both the layers. osmotic attraction in the drug layer pulls the water into the compartment, forming a suspension of the drug, and the osmotic agent in the lower compartment attracts water, expands upwards, and pushes the drug suspension out. So this is a dry system, which is a bilayered tablet coated with a semipermeable membrane and having an orifice. Water enters into both the chambers. The lower chamber consists of the osmogen, which exerts osmotic pressure, increases in volume, and pushes the upper layer. The upper layer of the tablet consists of drug, which, because of the absorption of water through the semipermeable membrane and being poorly soluble, now forms a suspension of the drug. And this suspension of the drug is pushed outwards because of the membrane that separates both the chambers. Thus, you can see if this is the initial profile of the bilayered tablet. After some time, you will find that the lower layer of the osmogen has expanded and pushed the drug layer outwards. Thus, inside the osmotic layer, osmotic pressure develops and it acts like a piston, and it expands, the chamber expands and propels the drug suspension out through the orifice. To learn more in detail about these various systems that I have just discussed here, you can refer the textbook Novel Drug Delivery System by A.K. Bandyopadhyay. This gives an excellent explanation of the different osmotic drug delivery systems. We now look at what is called as the mini osmotic pump. The mini osmotic pump is a type of implantable osmotic drug delivery system that can deliver the drug for long periods of time in months, including in months, and is used for delivery of hormones. This consists of a chamber with a flow moderator and a delivery portal, which has access to the drug reservoir and controls the rate of drug release. As you can see, the outermost layer is the semipermeable membrane, which encloses a chamber consisting of the drug reservoir and the osmotic agent. The osmotic agent is not in contact with the drug solution. Water enters through the semipermeable membrane, dissolves the osmotic agent, which exerts pressure and squeezes the innermost chamber that contains the drug reservoir. There is a delivery portal extending outwards, and the drug reserve solution or dispersion enters the delivery portal and is exerted and is delivered outside. A flow moderator is available to control the rate of drug delivery from this mini osmotic pump. Certain important aspects that need to be considered while designing such delivery systems, which are simple to look at but complex to formulate, design and manufacture on a commercial scale, is the extent of biocompatibility, because some of the excipients or the carriers or chambers that are designed are of the non-biodegradable type. So whether they are biocompatible, whether there is reliability of the extent and rate of drug release, the durability of these systems once administered into the body, their stability in the environment, accuracy of dosage, scalability of delivery from the systems, flow delivery, portability, reusability if any, extent of back pressure exerted once in situ, and the power that is consumed, especially in systems like the mini osmotic pump, are important considerations that need to be studied thoroughly in detail before designing such delivery systems. What are those parameters of the osmotic delivery systems that we need to evaluate if we are designing osmotic tablets? What is externally looks like a tablet, then all pre-compression parameters such as the powder, characteristics of the powder, moisture content, granule size, etc. need to be evaluated. Post-compressional parameters as given for tablets in any pharmacopoeia need to be evaluated. Third important aspect is to measure the pore diameter, the orifice diameter, because it is through this pore that the drug is solution or suspension is going to be extruded out into the gastrointestinal environment. Thickness of the semipermeable coating membrane, the in vitro drug dissolution characteristics, zero order release kinetics, because we are claiming that in this system follows zero order kinetics. First order release kinetics, once the zero order release kinetics is done, so after 80% of the drug is delivered by zero order kinetics, what is the kinetics of release of the remainder of the drug? Effect of the osmotic pressure on the delivery system and on the release of the drug needs to be evaluated. Effect of gastrointestinal pH environment on the extent of drug release needs to be investigated, and the agitation in the GI tract and due to gastric emptying needs to be evaluated. Thus, the characteristics of the tablet, if it is a tablet, as well as in situ characteristics including release kinetics, effect of osmotic pressure, pH, agitation are all parameters that need to be investigated in detail. In case of in vitro release characteristics, this can be carried out by the conventional USP paddle and basket type of apparatus. So, simple dissolution study and study of the profile of dissolution over a long period of time can be carried out. In this case, the dissolution medium used is generally distilled water as well as simulated gastric fluids and intestinal fluids. Many research papers carrying out the detailed dissolution characteristic evaluation of osmotic drug delivery systems can be found in literature, and you are expected to go through some of them. Standard specifications which are followed for oral control drug delivery systems are also applicable for oral osmotic pumps. In vivo evaluation of oral osmotic systems has been done, carried out mostly in dogs and to some extent in monkeys. Thus, in vitro evaluation and in vivo evaluation are important criteria to understand the performance of the osmotic drug delivery systems in the human body as well as outside. So with this, an overview of the osmotic drug delivery systems and their formulation aspects and different and few of the examples of osmotic drug delivery systems have been discussed here with. You can refer to any standard textbook, especially novel drug delivery systems by A.K. Bandyopadhyay, in which an entire chapter is dedicated to osmotic drug delivery systems. Also, an excellent review paper on osmotic drug delivery systems has been published in Pharma Times, January 2016 edition, volume 48, page number 11. So both these references, that is the Novel Drug Delivery Systems by A.K. Bandyopadhyay and a review in the Pharma Times, volume 48, January 2016, page number 11, will give you an excellent overview of osmotic systems. All of you are requested to go through the same and read about not only these systems, but several other systems of interest. Thank you.